Right, good evening. Evening, everybody. And welcome to the Junior Chamber's September meeting to our members. And we've got quite a lot of guests as well today. So welcome. I'm Oliver Brown, the president of 2016, the Junior Chamber. One of the things that, when I became president in April, that I was conscious of, I wanted the Junior Chamber to have a greater presence and connect more with the charitable sector and the social economy. So I appointed a chair of charities and social enterprise, and Benjamin kindly took up the baton and has been very busy ever since. So Benjamin, thank you for the work you've done so far in your few months. This is in part the first bit of that. I'm sure the people who are going to speak will give you a far better definition of what the social economy is. But I think from my point of view, you know, ever since the financial crisis, where kind of capitalism didn't really work, it broke. You know, we have seen an increase in the social economy, and in a way providing, filling a void between the private sector and the public sector, people perhaps having a more tangible stake in what goes on. This year so far, we have got involved with Babasa, which itself is a social enterprise, which helps young people in Bristol, 16 to 25 year olds. And the Junior Chamber has provided mentors and also some investment for these young startup enterprises. And actually two of the three that we have helped fund actually have real characteristics of a social enterprise, and perhaps one day we may get them to come in and speak about what they've done, but they're in fairly early stages at the moment. So that's enough from me. We've got a great lineup of speakers today. First up from the Quartet Foundation, we've got Sue Turner, who is Chief Executive, and Lucy Gilbert. Just as an aside, in 2009, the Junior Chamber actually put some money into a charitable pot that is managed by Quartet, and the income from that every year goes to some local charities, local causes in Bristol. So anyway, I will let the ladies.
Would you like to
do
the social enterprise works first?
Oh, is it? Right, oh gosh, sorry, I've got the order wrong. Right, so, ignore me. Okay, well we've got Carl, they will be on in a minute, we've got Carl Belizaire, who is from Social Enterprise Works. So, sorry about that, Carl.
Thank you very much.
Oh, very kind, very kind. So, evening, for those of you that aren't sat behind a pillar, the best place to catch all of your attention perhaps over here. So my name's Carl Belizaire, I'm the managing director of a 23-year-old development agency called Social Enterprise Works. And apologies for some of the social entrepreneurs in the room who might have heard me share some of these insights before, but I was under the impression this is your monthly meeting for Bristol Junior Chamber meetings. So part of my presentation is really speaking predominantly to all of you, really, to give a bit of an overview of the social economy here in Bristol. First of all, hands up. Who thinks they know what a social enterprise is? Yeah? Okay. Interestingly. So I just thought I'd make sure we're on the same page. There's a lot of confusion, misunderstanding about social enterprise particularly. And just to clarify, so you're all on the same page as myself, is that we're talking about businesses, fundamentally. It's just businesses that are set up with a primary social purpose. It's not just about making money. Money's important, but that's not principally why they exist. The EU took that a bit further and started to expand on some other characteristics around social enterprise. Beyond just their social purpose, but also the limited profit distribution, supporting redistribution of their profits back to address their social mission, but equally about participatory governance, having more people, either more people having a say in how things are run and how things are done, and that's typically some characteristics. I love throwing out this slide as the sort of dichotomy of the sector. Now, as I mentioned, people very much understand traditional charity, and they very much understand traditional business. But the space in the middle that we occupy is a lot less well understood, possibly because there's no one legal definition and there's a wide variety of different legal models which underpins it. The thing I find very fascinating at the moment is the sort of blurring of lines. More enterprises wanting to be social, more charities needing to be enterprising, a shrinking of the states. And I think all of this leads to quite an exciting time for collaboration, partly why we're here today, to come together to try and enable a more social economy that looks after the people and planet as well as just making lots of money. Worth mentioning that Bristol is one of the UK's first social enterprise places. For those who aren't familiar, a badge recognised by our national governing body, Social Enterprise UK, to sort of celebrate us as a city of social entrepreneurship. It's worth mentioning that we undertook a bit of research to try and kind of gain some evidence, really, to understand more about the sector. And one of the ways we did that was mapping it. So some of these little dots are a selection of the social enterprises here in Bristol, partly to illustrate it, but also, and really importantly, in cases you all very well understand, we had to present the business case. Why support social entrepreneurship? Why is it important? And typically, the two main kind of factors on this slide, typically, that government, and especially our local enterprise partnership and others, well understand is jobs and growth. And pound for pound, social enterprises are delivering significant amounts of jobs and growth, particularly in this region, in the Bristol area alone, 10,000 jobs and £38 million generated every year. The social enterprises in every sector. Social enterprises in any one particular sector. In fact, we cover quite a variety, typically responding to need, children and young people services and well-being being quite prolific. But just to sort of highlight that social enterprise is increasingly existing in very traditional sectors and traditional industries. I can't help but blasting you with information, I'm sorry. I'm going to scan over some of these slides, but just to illustrate some quick case studies, really. Finance sector. We've got a huge credit union here, an alternative banking model. Which redistributes its profit rather than going to shareholders and is built on a membership base. Again, doing things slightly differently, but for more social rather than just profit-driven outcomes. We've got our own energy companies. I work with organisations up in Lawrence Weston to raise community shares to buy a solar farm so they can create revenue to drive back into their communities to keep providing a sustainable revenue for community development and doing good things in the locality. Increasing number of food producers, lots of the food industries are setting themselves up as community interest companies and social enterprises, aligning with the values. There's been a myriad of Grow Bristol, Incredible Edible and others sort of springing up across the city. And possibly one of the biggest social enterprises in Bristol is Bristol Community Health, which is interestingly a community interest company and an NHS spin-out, which provides services to about 37,000 people every year across the city. So again, not all of the social enterprises we support are very very big. Many of them are very small. In fact, we've got some social entrepreneurs in the room here today. Could you give us a raise your hands? But a few fellows that we thought we'd bring along, a few social enterprises, social entrepreneurs in their own right. Small organizations doing wonderful things. We've got a publishing company. What are you doing again? A communications organization. We've got an online marks out of tenancy. We've got the region's first social enterprise security firm. So again, very traditional industries that we're challenging the perceptions of business as usual with. One of the big drivers for change, particularly within a local authority sort of level, has been the introduction of something called the Public Services Act, which is a way about thinking about the social and environmental benefits of every pound spent with public bodies, particularly local councils. I'm very proud to say that here in Bristol, we're one of the handful of councils in the whole country that are actually taking this policy further than just a consideration and have taken the commitment to adopt it to £330 million worth of public spend. And again, we're very grateful to have a colleague from Bristol City Council come and join us this evening. Jacqueline, over here if you want to chat to her later. Coming back to all of yourselves, as well as the sort of public sector, our Minister for Civil Society, who's still the Minister for Civil Society despite the reshuffle, has sort of made a corporate pledge, challenging businesses to spend £1 billion with social enterprise over the next few years and encourage more social organisations into your supply chains to increase more sustainability for the sector. And finally, I just thought I'd leave you with an intriguing thought, really, which in this past few years, quite a few leaders of industry, very traditional, might seen as capitalist leaders of industry, Richard Branson, Adriana Huffington, Huffington Poe, CEO of Puma, etc., came together to develop a little group called the B Team. And we're profoundly claiming that there's a plan B for business, and what's good for people and the planet is also good for the bottom line. Proclaiming that organisations that don't have a purpose will cease to exist in the future. I think that's quite fascinating that you've got what is seen as very glorious camaraderie of capitalism talking about this broader concept of purpose and sustainability for private sector organisations, which in some way, shape or form affects everybody in the room here today. I think it's a really exciting time, and I'm really pleased that Benjamin approached us and came to talk to us about the prospect of collaborating together, and I'm really excited about the opportunities that you all can bring to help the social economy grow and thrive here in Bristol for now and for many years to come. So thanks for listening. That was me.
Just wondered if anyone's getting any, we're going to sort of, each speaker's got sort of 10 minutes or so, and then we'll have sort of a few questions if anyone's got any for Carl. I've got one. Which social enterprise do you most look up to?
Ooh, that's a good question. And I don't want to steal the thunder because I believe someone might talk about it later, but there is a female-led social enterprise in the creative industries called Paper Arts.
Okay.
Who have been signed up with a pop-up shop. I don't want to steal the thunder too much, but I've gone on to do wonderful things, including purchase a four-story building in town and create the first UK's first creative social business incubator, which is a fantastic success story that you're going to hear more about later.
Okay.
Anyone else?
Yep, Tom.
What's the greatest, what is the greatest challenge facing the social economy of Bristol?
The greatest challenge, one of the biggest challenges personally I feel, and I'm sure others may concur, is the it's actually public awareness. I spend quite a lot of time providing skills and support and space and money and all the rest of it, but if 9 out of 10 people on the street who ask what a social enterprise, I mean, half of you in the room hadn't even heard of any of your professionals working in the industry. So if you ask the average person on the street what we're talking about, the awareness is very low. So I think that in addition to the improving the environment, increasing capacity and skills, we've still got a long way to go to increase general public understanding. So it's like fair trade standards that everybody gets to understand.
One more? Okay, good. Thank you. Thank you very much, Carl. Benjamin, who am I having next? Just so I don't get on. Right, okay, good. Right. So now, after the big build-up, now it's time for Quartet. So if Sue and Lucy would like to come up. Thank you.
Brilliant. Well, thank you very much. Thank you very much for the invitation, Oliver and Benjamin, for all your ideas and energy around this theme. It's very exciting. And what I'm going to tell you about is some history, and then Lucy's going to share with you some current experiences as well, and talk to you about the Community Foundation and the work that is already going on through Bristol Junior Chamber and what we'd like to do in the future. To start with, I'll introduce you to this chap, Frederick H. Gough. Oh, the serious-looking gentleman. So am I standing in the way there? I'll shuffle that way a bit. Frederick H. Gough was a philanthropist, a banker, and a lawyer in Cleveland, Ohio, in the early part of the 20th century. And he got really very fed up that people were dying, and in their wills they were leaving money for specific purposes, which might have been a good idea at the time when they wrote their will in 18-something or other, but by the time they died, and some years after their death, the money was getting stuck. So money might be left, for example, to the education of the children of chimney sweeps, which sounded like a good idea at one point in time, but as years went on, the money was stuck. There weren't enough children of chimney sweeps that needed to be educated. So Frederick H. Gough called it the dead hand of the dead reaching out from beyond the grave to control all these pots of money, and they were redundant. They couldn't be used for anything useful. So he said, why don't we stop doing this? Why don't we instead have a central pot, let's call it a community foundation, that we can all put our money into, and we'll rely on those who come after us to know what are the issues of the day, what are the particular causes that the money needs to be applied to. So that's what he did. He set up the first community foundation in the world, in Cleveland, Ohio, in 1914. That community foundation has gone on from strength to strength. They now have a permanent endowment, capital that doesn't get spent but is invested, of $1.8 billion. And they've spent $1 billion from the income that the money's earned over the past 100 years on all sorts of good causes around the Cleveland area. From that, lots of other community foundations have been spawned. The biggest one in the world is in Silicon Valley, as you might imagine, and they have a $6 billion endowment. As we'll describe in a few minutes, our endowment is a little smaller than that here in Bristol, but that's the direction we want to travel in. To give you a few facts and figures and things that might put philanthropy and giving into context and make it real for you, there's a very different attitude in the UK to philanthropy compared to in the US. Giving in the UK has not increased in real terms in 30 years, and that's despite wealth increasing. We now have 117 billionaires in the UK, compared with just 9 in 1989. So the wealth's going up, but in real terms, the giving isn't. We're perhaps not so philanthropically minded. Not a lot of people know it, but if you're earning £34,000 or more a year in this country, you're in the wealthiest 1% in the world. So philanthropy is within the reach, I think, of probably most people in this room. So Lucy's now going to tell you about some projects that we've invested in, and then I'll describe some more about the mechanism and how it works. Over to Lucy.
So this is Paper, Artistic Development, Community Interest Company. Paper is a young social enterprise giving opportunities for talented young people to succeed in creative careers. Last year, we supported them with £2,000 to set up their Creative Advice Bureau, offering free careers advice for young people not in education, employment or training, NEETs, and for vulnerable adults. The project also employed a NEET young person, intern, to help manage the project. Nearly 6% of Bristol's 16 to 18-year-olds are not in education, employment or training, and there are a further 10% that we just don't know about. Most at risk of becoming NEET are pupils who were eligible for free school meals, people who were excluded from school, people with mental health issues, and people with disabilities. These groups already face multiple disadvantages, and long periods of employment increase the likelihood that a young person's life chances could be negatively impacted. Paper's Creative Advice Bureau gave specialist one-to-one guidance to 73 young people over 6 months, increasing their confidence and skills to pursue creative careers. One young woman, Sarah, was incredibly talented but hadn't felt confident enough to show her artwork to anyone but her family before. After working with the Creative Advice Bureau, she was well on her way to self-employment and her confidence had soared. Overall, the scheme was a huge success and shows that a very small amount of funding can catalyse multiple benefits for our society and our local economy. And as Carl mentioned, they've gone on to do absolutely fantastic things. We at the Community Foundation are increasingly supporting social enterprises and community interest companies as more and more charities are looking for new ways to diversify their income and to source sustainable income. Here is another example. This is Buzz Luckley's, which is a community interest company set up by a neighbouring charity, the North Bristol Advice Service, in response to needs in the area. Lockleys ranks among the most deprived 10% in the country, scoring particularly poorly for employment, education and skills. So starting the journey to make changes in this community, we've awarded over £13,000 in setup costs for this new community hub, liaising with unflappable director Sally and her team. The site contains an affordable healthy food shop, an employability project, and an enterprise hub which gives small business startup grants to local residents. Buzz Lockleys is now a blossoming social enterprise and a hugely valuable resource for this community. Where other funders aren't able to take risks on new initiatives, we can, and we do. We're independent and we have a long-term focus, and that enables us to do this. It's a really new and exciting area of our work that we really hope that you'll be excited by too and want to take part in.
To me. So to give you a picture overall of Quartet's work, last year we gave out more than £2.5 million in grants to a very wide range of people, some of them in social enterprises, others aspiring to become social enterprises but not knowing how to get started and needing a lot of help along the way. Our monitoring shows that the work we do really does affect the lives of hundreds of thousands of disadvantaged people all across the west of England who just need a bit of help. Of course, what we do is help people like you find the Sallys and the Sarahs who need help and support. To give you a bit of a picture about how it actually works, we're all about philanthropy advice. We started in 1987, so next year we'll be celebrating our 30th anniversary and putting out all sorts of information, events and activities, and we'd love to see you at those participating in them. I mentioned earlier on we have an endowment of £24 million, which we don't spend, we invest, and we've given out over £40 million in grants and other assistance since we first started in 87. Annually, it's about 1,000 organisations that we work with, so it's a lot of reach across this area. And crucially, we have to pass very, very stringent quality assurance standards, so we can't make it up as we go along. There's a method behind what we do, it's very precise, it's very detailed, and we're audited within an inch of our lives to make sure we're doing everything absolutely properly. So the quality assurance is there, and we de-risk the transaction. When you think about some of the bad news stories that you might read about charities, because we're doing so much due diligence, we don't get involved in that, and we keep everything on the straight and narrow. We have a process, I won't talk you through this in detail, but we have a process that we work through. But one thing I will just mention is this segment at the top here. It talks about identifying and responding to local needs. How do we know what the needs are out in society and how they're changing? Well, Lucy and the team have been doing a huge amount of work on that, and we, on the 4th of October, we'll be publishing a report which looks at social needs across the west of England, how they're changing and where the emphasis needs to be put in order to make the most difference to people who are most disadvantaged. So, what can you do to help? Well, we'll talk in a moment about the Bristol Junior Chamber Fund, but as I mentioned, having a philanthropical mindset is open to all of you. Desmond Tutu said, "We can all start to even out inequality through philanthropy." That's open to you. And just like we're all taught not to put off starting our pensions until sometime in the future, there's no reason to put off being philanthropic. Through the Bristol Junior Chamber and what you have set up here, you can do your bit today. I'll give you an example of how things escalate and how they snowball. There's one lady who's one of our longest standing fund holders. She set up a fund with us 25 years ago with just £13,000. That fund has now grown to be worth £45,000, and in the intervening 25 years, she's given away £13,000. So the value of endowment and constantly being able to give is proven again and again. One thing I recommend to you, if any of you like books like me, this book by William McCaskill that came out last year, Doing Good Better, is a really thoughtful way of thinking about philanthropy and how to get involved. He reckons that we spend 80,000 hours of our lives at work. So if we can do some of that work to put back, or use some of the income that we gain from all that work to put back into society, then we'll all be doing an extremely good job, just like your fund does. So Lucy's now going to tell you more about the fund.
So, you may be aware that the Bristol Junior Chamber has a fund with Quartet, set up in 2009 with donations of around £13,000. Your fund is actually worth £22,000. Because you've made use of government match funding challenges over the years. This is a permanent endowment, so the capital will never be spent, and it will be there forever to support local people in the Bristol Junior Chamber's name. Your fund generates approximately £750 in income every year to be spent on charitable projects or social enterprises, and the aims of your fund are for young people's projects, mostly, but projects that focus on business, employability, education, those kinds of things. In recent years, you've donated to 1625 Independent People, which is a homelessness charity for young people, and to Rework for a project helping tackling disadvantage in Knowle West. So what can you do next? You can use the fund's income wisely. We're here to support that, and through Benjamin's new scheme, this will be a fantastic opportunity for you to engage with the fund and to use that income to best effect. You can add to the fund. It's a permanent resource that will be there forever, and we're there to support you and will claim all of the gift aid on your behalf. If you're a professional advisor, you can become involved in philanthropy through referring clients to us, and you can influence your employer to set up a fund or to add to any funds that they hold with us already. Right now, you have £715 to spend on grant making, and inspired by what you'll hear this evening, we hope that you'll choose to put that towards a social enterprise locally. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Have you got any questions for Andrew?
Yeah, I'm just wondering, the decrease in interest rates, has that had a big hit on your organisation if you're using the interest from money to invest through what you're doing to counter that?
Yeah, so our £24 million endowment is invested, most of it with Smith & Williamson locally, but some of it with an app called CCLA out in London. And rather than just sticking it in the bank and then take the hit when interest rates are scraping the floor, they actually have a portfolio approach to it. So we protect capital, partly, but we're also looking for income. In the aftermath of Brexit, you can imagine we have a little moment thinking, what's this mean for our investments, and therefore for what the grant making will be able to do. But of course, the stock market has really rebounded very strongly, and Smith & Williamson have done extremely well in some of the ways that they've lined up the portfolio, and CCLA have as well. So the portfolio is now a lot stronger than it was at the beginning of the year. So we're doing well. We target our investment managers to return 4% above RPI, and they may not do it in any particular quarter, but over a 3 to 5 year period, that's what they return. So the funds that we've got, we know will have 4% to return and future thinking.
Ben?
Is it worth mentioning
Yeah, well, yeah, we have one there because when Benjamin and I went to see the quartet, yeah, I mean, anyone is entitled can put money into this fund. And we actually have a former president, bless him, puts a small amount every month into the fund. Sadly, he's the only one who does it, but should you have enjoyed your time so much at the Junior Chamber or you want it to go to a sort of a localised cause, then please, I would encourage you. I think you can do any amount, literally, it can be pounds, you know. So yeah, that's definitely something we can send details around, and I suspect all past presidents perhaps should be starting with the past president up there. You talk about the top 1%, top 0.1%, definitely. So, okay. Got a question.
What's your most successful, most interesting buzz project?
I do.
Your buzz, not pleasing.
Yeah.
What's the most interesting project that you've had to fund?
In buzz, not pleasing?
Yeah, because you give away grants of £750 to local companies. Is that right?
Within buzz, we've helped fund them to set up that project. They're now independently working. And so the £750 a month. It's what you, as the Bristol Junior Chamber, have to spend on grants, and you can decide to spend that wherever you like.
And quartet's grants, the ones we've given out, I said it's about £2.5 million a year. Some of those are tiny. £35 was the smallest one in the previous financial year, which was to buy some high-vis jackets and some preschool children for the pool from the village hall where they have their preschool around the corner to the playground to get some fresh air and some exercise. So small amounts of money really make a difference. And then the largest one would be perhaps £70,000, which would be spread over 3 years to a charity to really make a difference and make a step change of what it's doing. So they're very variable. And the key thing to remember is you might think £715, well, that's not a lot of money, you can't really do much with that. Yes, you can. There's a way we work, we can match funding and put these together other projects, but it really does change lives.
Yes, yeah.
Have you got a sense of whether it's generous or a little bit stingy when it comes to giving versus the rest of the world?
We're a little bit stingy. I think the telling thing is a public opinion poll that was carried out in 1940 1948, just after the welfare state was set up, where 96% of the Brits at that point in time thought there would be no need for any more philanthropy because the welfare state would look after everything. Of course, we don't want to pay enough taxes to make that vision come true. Compared to America, in America, higher rate taxpayers, 92% of them feel it's their duty to be here on proper, put more in rather than just pay the taxes. In the UK, 46% of top rate taxpayers think they've got no obligation to do anything other than pay the taxes. So it's a really different answer.
Do you get any sort of bigger businesses coming to you with the corporate and social responsibility looking to spend the federal money on the services? Is that happening?
I joined Quartet in October last year from the private sector background. I expected to find a lot more businesses amongst our portfolio of funds, but actually there are not many. So the company I used to be with, Bristol Port Company, that runs the Doctech Open House and Portbury, has a very sizable fund with Quartet, and that was my experience. Part of my job was looking after that fund and talking to the team about how we used it for a good project around the area. But no, the vast majority of businesses don't have funds with us. Sometimes it's because they think they're too small, they're not, but they haven't got into that mindset of putting back in. Other times it's because they're not controlled here. So typically in the 1980s, the companies that were based in this area, you had head offices here, they were setting up funds. But then through the 90s and the early noughties, lots of them got taken over. Head offices disappeared to London or overseas, and that decision making, that view of wanting to invest back into the local community, disappeared with the head offices. So it's very difficult now for us to get new funds to be set up. We do have a vehicle where people can go doing, say, cake sales and fun runs, all sorts of things that employees do. There's a vehicle that we can channel that money through into Quartet for grant making, which is perhaps a little bit more creative than just straightforward having a corporate fund. But we'd love to crack that and more companies in the
I'm curious, are you interested? Is this one part of the question?
No, it's a bigger thing. When you see the annual accounts now for companies, there's a whole section of corporate social responsibility, isn't there? So there's a move to spend sort of money in that area. And I thought giving it to somebody by yourself to look after is an easy way to just write the check and let you manage it.
It's rather than
have somebody in house manage it.
Yeah.
You said it.
That's why the court set up their fund back in 1993, because it used to take over the business and prioritise it. Council, and they were getting all these letters in, so saying, help us, and you know, pay some for the scouts, and something for a football club, and this, that, and the other. And they said, we don't know how to make these decisions. What's fair? Who can we trust to apply the money and do something good with it? So they set up the fund with Quartet and said, hey, Quartet, here's the paperwork, you make the decision to make it work. And that fund now is worth £360,000, and that gives them about £10,000 a year in grant making. So it's a very healthy pot that just builds up our managers every year.
I see what you're saying about subsidiaries, but that doesn't stop subsidiaries doing that sort of thing. They're not talking about that to companies. I'm not going to work as a subsidiary, but I think company. I know that we need lots of new things that we use here.
As I should have mentioned, there's a network of community foundations all around the country, so even if you're not actually in Bristol, we cover Bristol, Bath, North Somerset, and South Gloucestershire, but there's another community foundation in Gloucestershire, there's another one in Wiltshire, there's one in Somerset, Dorset, Devon. So wherever you are, wherever your business interests are or personal interests, there's a community foundation you need to work to, just like we do, would like to talk to you.
Okay, one last one.
We've asked about how UK compares with other countries. How does Bristol compare with the rest of the country?
Barclays Wealth did a survey recently on comparing the different regions, and it showed that the southwest, not just Bristol, but that wider southwest, going as far as Devon and Cornwall, is second wealthiest to London and the southeast. But we're not exactly generous, so we do have a generosity gap. Bristol, in particular, has always tended to focus on people doing their own things. Like independent spirit, we love about Bristol, we're really passionate about it. And I think perhaps reflect better in social enterprises. But it does mean that people don't tend to want to be part of a sort of something they see as too organised and too structured. So perhaps we need to free up the spirit to be independent through the route of social enterprise, and perhaps through what all this works for.
Okay, that was really great. Thank you very much. So, round of applause. we'll circulate the details of quartets on the weekly email and everyone who's spoken tonight as well, just so you can find out a little bit more and connect with myself or Ben. Right, our last speaker, last but not least, is Oliver Mochizuki. Got it. Good.
Very happy with that.
CEO of FunSurfer, which is a very interesting social enterprise that Oliver's now going to talk to us about.
Cool. So I'll just kick off to find out exactly what kind of level of understanding of crowdfunding we have. So can I get a show of hands who feels that they really understand crowdfunding, what it is and how it works? And keep your hands up if you think you know about the different models of crowdfunding. Okay, so I'm going to do it really fast. You are the brightest minds in Bristol, so I'm going to fire quite a lot of information at you guys, so hopefully you'll be able to pick it up. So just give you a very brief overview. FunSurfer is a fintech platform. It's crowdfunding and commercial finance. But when we actually created FunSurfer, we saw very quickly that crowdfunding was going to lose its buzzword status, and it would really just become one way that you fund a company or project or social enterprise. So within 2 months of launching, I started to look at what other funding options are out there. So what could we actually provide our clients and the system with? And it very quickly just was so clear to me, it's not about one funding option. It's about the best funding option for your project or your company. So for example, if you're a social enterprise, it's difficult. You know, you were very restricted previously. Me and Carl go back a really long time, and we created a social enterprise when you didn't have a CIC and social enterprise wasn't really a thing. And it was a really tough uphill struggle for us to deliver it, because we were in between a company and a charity. So now we have crowdfunding, which has broken out really since the financial crash in 2007, where you had the banks retreated from lending, so businesses couldn't get the money they needed. Charities, social enterprises, whatever social organization it was, they suddenly started to see all of their donations, specifically CSR, is usually one of the first things to get cut back in any time a company is tightening its belt. So with FunSurfer, we started to add different funding options. So within crowdfunding, you have the classic Kickstarter model I'm sure everyone knows about, reward and donation-based crowdfunding. If you're an artist, you might offer a copy of your album, you might offer a personal gig at your house or whatever it may be, you can be creative. But then we have equity crowdfunding, which is one of the reasons the UK is the fintech capital of the world. America has only just this year in April begun to use equity crowdfunding. We've been doing it for 6 years. So we have a really strong background and heritage now within crowdfunding, and also within peer-to-peer, which is essentially crowdfunded loans. Those are the main types of crowdfunding options you can look at. Peer-to-peer lenders, can you see a show of hands? Who's heard of Funding Circle? You've probably seen all the adverts on TV. So what's interesting with Funding Circle is that they started out really wealthy investors wanting to lend to companies. But what's happened now is venture capital funds have plowed in there. So I don't know how alternative peer-to-peer lending is when it's being supported by New York hedge funds putting in 130 million to lend to UK companies. But it's a huge success story. They've lent over £1 billion to UK businesses. I think they hit that billion point, just this year. So it's really opening up a huge amount of opportunity for organizations, whether you're a social enterprise or a commercial organization. There is a vast amount of funding options available. So for FunSurfer, we have access to VC funds. We've mapped out all of the virtual reality funds, for example. Who are the big players? Who's investing in the space? Who's investing in the area? We have access to family offices from around the world. We started in Bristol. We are actually based in this very amazing place that is Set Squared. We were here for 18 months. We went through incubation. So we really know the value of support. And this is really what sets FunSurfer apart from other more sort of traditional crowdfunding platforms. We provide access to a unique blend of funding options, but also the support that you need to go out and get the funding. It is just, if not as important, more important than actually being, than getting funding, is being ready for investment and ready for funding. So I was absolutely delighted to have the opportunity when Benjamin contacted me and explained his idea and the plan to bring the chamber in, the junior chamber, to support a number of amazing projects in Bristol. Another unique element with Fundsurfer, we actually turn away 90-95% of the clients that approach us. The reason we do that is because we're not looking to work with just anyone. We want to work with projects that have real merit, add something to the world, help people out. Me and Carl have been involved in social enterprise forever. It's my passion area. You know, things have escalated somewhat quickly. We're looking at building eco schools in Afghanistan as an example with the Afghan Education Ministry. Not entirely sure how I ended up in Qatar with the Afghan Education Ministry having that conversation, but that's where things are going. And that is testament to the power of alternative finance. So you all have an amazing opportunity here to look at different projects that we're going to bring forward and put in front of you guys and girls, and you can support those projects, but not just with money. And this is the really core part of it. Crowdfunding is about much more than just money. Money is great and you need it to succeed, but you also need support and help. You might need someone to come and volunteer. I know some of the people in the room are probably accountants or lawyers or in some way able to support this project with their commercial background or experience. So what I want to do now is introduce a few of the projects. These are just projects that we're working with at the moment. We have some other really cool stuff coming down the road that we'll be able to bring to you because as Benjamin has stressed, this is about supporting the social economy. This is about a long-term commitment, and it's not about just throwing 20 quid into a crowdfunding campaign and thank you very much. This is about getting involved for the longer term and being able to support projects that are amazing and really need your help, and hopefully that you'll get something out of being involved with. And I think that's the really important thing. So the first project that I want to introduce is something I really love. It's not helping my waistline, I have to be honest, because it's 91 Ways, the International Peace Cafes, and the food that they cook is amazing. So this is 91 Ways. There's 91 languages spoken in Bristol, and these guys do pop-up peace cafes in local communities to bring people together. And this is something I really love. So I'm going to just show you very quickly the video for 91 Ways. Well, I was going to, but that's gone a bit wrong. Okay, that might be a problem with the Wi-Fi, but let me try this one. Okay, so this is A-Box Convoy. I'll go back to 91 Ways. This project, I'm sure everyone appreciates, there is a terrible situation in Syria right now. And this was an incredible example of Bristol coming together. The team behind A-Box Convoy, hands up who goes to music festivals. Okay, so you've probably all been to one in Bristol, I'm sure, in the Southwest. The team behind those music festivals came together, and instead of going to Asia, India, Asia, Thailand, which is normally what they do for holiday, they all went to Dunkirk, they all went to Calais, and they basically helped raise over £50,000 for different projects. This is the A-Box Convoy team.
Because theirs is really wet.
that one's really dear to my heart. We really quickly looked to get involved with the refugee crisis last year, and we've since raised over £180,000 for different refugee charities that distributing aid. Now, this was something where, you know, I really saw the best of Bristol, quite honestly. You know, the skills that you learn running Glastonbury Pyramid Stage, sadly, are actually quite applicable when it comes to managing huge, you know, aid distribution programs. So this is something that we're, you know, really behind. And unfortunately, the problem isn't necessarily going away, but there is massive donor fatigue. Everyone sort of feels as though, wow, that was last year, wasn't it? Surely that isn't happening anymore. I'm afraid it still is. You know, there's still 800 kids in Calais, for Christ's sake, under 12 years old. You know, this is not acceptable. So sorry for the slight bummer coming in straight away, because I know this is quite a heavy subject, and I wanted to warm up with a really nice peace cafe and look at how everyone's happy and whatnot. But this is a really serious project, and, you know, it's something that we'd love to put in front of the chain. But there's a lot you can do. If any of you want to actually get involved and come out to the camps, then we can facilitate that. So I'd now like to show you the next project, which is for Bristol Media. And this is to send from one of Bristol's deprived areas, one of the areas in Bristol that, you know, really needs support to help break into the creative industries. Bristol Media, if you don't know, is the largest creative community that we have in the Southwest, and we're raising funds to fund a bursary to send them to South by Southwest, arguably the greatest interactive festival and event in America, in Texas. While they're there, they'll get to make content and creative content. So I'll just show you this video.
A lot of agencies have in Bristol is there's skill shortages, especially in growing digital sectors. And frankly, we're just not drawing from as diverse a talent pool as we should do. The challenge a lot of young people face, especially from more diverse backgrounds, is how to get into this sector. It's growing, but it's not easy to access. So Bristol Media can help this situation by connecting the two groups together. We've got agencies on the one side looking for exciting new talent. We've got young people looking for great job opportunities. Bristol Media can be the catalyst to connect those two groups together. We're planning a really exciting opportunity for one young person to go to Austin, Texas, for South by Southwest in 2017. It will be a chance to be mentored by an experienced creative director from Bristol Media to produce live content when they're out there, but also get involved in a whole series of opportunities to make their mark and make connections before and after South by Southwest.
So ideally with Bristol Media, what they want to see happen is this to become, you know, this is the pilot, as it were, this is the trial. Now, alongside being the CEO of Funsurfer, I'm also a film producer. I have a film company in LA called Ghost Rain Pictures. We work on feature films from $5 to $25 million. And, you know, I really had to work unbelievably hard to break into that industry. It helped that I'm a little bit older than the average graduate when I came out of film school, because I went as a mature student. But the creative industries is one of the most hardest, difficult industries to break into. So this is a great opportunity to help a young person from a deprived area, you know, get the experience on the ground and after, and then hopefully we're going to roll out and launch maybe a whole bunch of young people going to South by Southwest, maybe Coachella, and yeah. So now I'm just going to show you the video for 91 Ways. So this was supposed to be the nice warm-up you guys had before I took you to a pretty heavy place.
There are 91 languages spoken in Bristol.
Saya orang Bristol.
Nyanyi Bristolian.
Awesome Bristol, challenge of momenta.
91 ways to bring all of these communities together.
I am 91.
I am 91.
I am 91.
We are 91.
Last year, we launched Bristol's first International Peace Cafe. was a fantastic, warm event. Over 200 people came. What we do is we create events. We ask people to come from all over the city, come and sit, talk, eat and share food with us. And when we do that, people actually start connecting. Food is a language common to us all.
My favourite food is huckleberry.
My favourite food is lobster curry.
My favourite food is a roast dinner.
When we share food, we share our values, we share our memories, we share our heritage and our culture. Bristol's a great city. It's fast moving, it's creative. What I want to do is get people to know each other, work together. When we do that, I think we'll have an even stronger city than we've got now. I think 91 Ways can be a template, not just for Bristol, but for the whole of the UK. Cities are becoming more diverse. There are more and more cultures that are having to live together. How do you make that work? It's the same challenge.
I was born in Russia in a town called Tolyatti.
And I came from Syria.
I'm from the Czech Republic.
I'm originally from South Africa.
Our cooks are cooks who already cook in the community. They'll cook for weddings, they'll cook for births, they'll cook for all sorts of occasions. We want to give them skills which will really help them. If they want to, they can continue that career. It's going to be a great place for empowering people. Join our crowdfunding campaign. Take a stake in what we're doing. Pledge with us. Take a stake in making Bristol an even more wonderful city.
So that's the three projects we've got a video for. We also have a really amazing, it's a national homeless charity, but we're going to be launching a campaign in Bristol for this Christmas. And we're actually experimenting with contactless crowdfunding for the very first time. It's kind of pushing the boundaries for what is actually possible from the technology side of things. So if you imagine, there'll be contactless chips built into bus stop posters, and you'll be able to literally just tap it with your card, with your contactless card, to make a donation. I've got my tech co-founder telling me reliably it's possible, so I'm just going to go ahead and say, yeah, we're just definitely going to be doing that. But if it doesn't quite work out, you know, you can blame Derek. He's not here, so, you know, I'll throw him under the bus, that's fine. So, look, we have had an amazing response to our company since we launched in Bristol. You know, we're working with clients in 25 different countries. You know, we really love helping amazing projects and companies get funded. But one of the things I enjoy more than anything is working with social enterprises, supporting the social economy, and Bristol has been a fantastic city for that. And I would really welcome the opportunity to support and work with any one of these projects with the Chamber. And we will also be introducing some other projects for you to review and look at as well. So thanks a lot for listening, and I look forward to catching up with all of you soon. Thank you.
Some hard-hitting stuff there. Questions? Anyone got any questions for Oliver?
James. How are social enterprises regulated? I can see it being a very good way of setting a company up. Oh, I'm not for profit, but I happen to take it.
It's a really good question.
Yeah, I mean, there is one dedicated legal form for social enterprises, which is a community interest company. The community interest company does have its own regulator, the CIC regulator. It actually sits in Companies House over in Cardiff. So essentially, yeah, a proportion of the social enterprise. Admittedly, as I mentioned, there's a number of different forms you could take. So some organisations could be a limited company by guarantee, claim that they do social things and call themselves a social enterprise. There's certain kind marks available, there's certain memberships available, and there's a certain regulator through the CIC regulator, which I believe is as arduous as the Charity Commission. But it's it asks you a few extra questions than you would typically to submit your annual returns for your typical private enterprise. So there's some level of regulation.
It's fair to say it's a grey area on some hand, on one hand, isn't it? Because you do have companies that are entirely limited, you know, a limited company for profit, but they write into their articles perhaps that they'll give 30% of their profits to charity, but there isn't actually anyone to regulate that and ensure that happens. So Unlimited, which gives out grants to social enterprises, they gave a lot of money to companies that, yeah, limited companies for profit. You kind of just have to sort of hope that they're going to do what they say they're going to do. But yeah, it is a little bit tricky because CIC isn't the right fit for everyone, and to be a full-blown charity isn't the right fit as well. So I don't know. I mean,
there are other kind of marks. So for example, there's been the recent introduction of something called B Corp, which again is a sort of independent triple line bottom accounting, which essentially would be another method of verifying, legitimising your social purpose, I suppose, as well as your impact. I mean, historically, there's been the social enterprise mark, which did a similar sort of thing. They were very militant about you had to give 50% of your profits redistributed back into your business, otherwise you're not a social enterprise, which sort of... So yeah, there's similar regulation, there's clearly some way to go. And currently, on the profit with purpose, the Cabinet Office is currently exploring mission-led businesses, which are profit with purpose, private companies limited by shares that also do good. So there's certainly an evolving landscape, you know, because like you say, there's no one size fits all. So it's, yeah.
On fund server, I was interested to know what sort of percentage of the social enterprise you're funding actually gives a return, or is it all about just giving your money and hoping that it's going to do good and do well and create more social security, or some of them actually offering money back as an improper investment as well?
Yeah, it's a mix. I mean, one of the, you know, for straight donation projects, you know, it's quite clear, here's a donation, you know, take my donation, do what you will with it. But we also did a lot of work with social investment. So we actually worked with Resonance, who launched the UK's first social investment tax relief fund. So that's called SITR funding. It's effectively a way for a high net worth or a wealthy individual to invest into a social enterprise and receive some degree of return. So, I mean, it's hard to just pull out the number, but I'd say 70-30 maybe, with the lean towards straight donations to charities.
Well, then just on that note, it's interesting that the differentiator between Just Giving and FundSurfer is the reward. And I find it really fascinating that we're all not as altruistic as we might like and Just Give, and there's a bit of a donor fatigue as well. There's something about getting something back in return for a donation. So whether it's a postcard, a thank you, an event invitation, often the more unique, the better. I love the 20th century flicks up in Clifton. Some of one of their rewards was one of a limited edition number of membership cards from 20 years ago that, you know, everybody really wanted because it was so unique. So they're giving money, but they're getting something back. Now, they're not getting the same level of financial contribution back as what they pledged, but there's a bit of a quid pro quo about it. So I think that's kind of an interesting dynamic.
I think their best reward was, we will recreate your favourite Catherine Bigelow scene from Point Break for £40. Now, the insane thing there is, of course, they were never going to do that, but 60 people gave them £40 to do that, you know? So with rewards, reward donation-based crowdfunding, it's very much about coming up with quirky, fun and unique products that are both, products and experiences, effectively. You know, because you can't get those anywhere else, as an example.
Yeah. We started off by saying that there was a general lack of awareness around the public generally, around the whole social enterprise environment, and yet there are all this whole myriad of different organisations. So what's the sort of collective view in terms of how the public are better educated and ultimately how benefactors are better matched to the right model?
If I can start on community foundations, as mentioned, Cleveland Community Foundation, over 100 years old, they still say we're not well enough. No, people out there in the community still don't know what we do. Community foundations certainly go through an evolution, if you like, a sort of maturity, where they start off just talking to a very small group of high net worth individuals, and then as they grow and they mature, they start talking to more and more people and building up until they become fully inclusive and they see themselves as a vehicle for anybody to participate in giving something back to society. I'd say we're still at the spotty teenager phase of our maturity, where there's a core of people who know very well what we do. We want to reach out and make what we do available and open to many, many more. we've got our 30th anniversary next year, as I mentioned, and that really is the vehicle for us to start a lot more conversations. The work that Lucy and the team have been working on social media, again, that's going to be a big tool, which will wake people up and say, I didn't realise that we have these problems on our doorstep in 21st century Bristol, Bath, North Somerset and South Gloucestershire. And I now know there's a way I can do something about it. But it's very slow, and if Cleveland, Ohio haven't cracked it yet, then we've still got a way to go. But I think by doing the more creative things, as we said earlier on, you know, Bristol, there is that independent spirit, that creative spirit. So perhaps we can leapfrog through the spotty teenager phase and get to full maturity and reach many more people by teaming up with others.
I was thinking about, before spending this past year with Social Enterprise Works, I used to work for the Foundation for Social Entrepreneurs and commute to London a few days a week. And I spent 3 years as a national policy manager, and that was partly my remit. How do we mainstream the movement? We're currently a niche, how do we make it mainstream? And there's a few factors. I think there's some practical things that I was currently, as part of my future strategy, is a comms thing. We've got a community radio station, so I need to get my own radio show. We've got a community TV channel, I need to get on TV. We've got community publications like Outbound and others that we could be doing more publishing. So generally the kind of creating content and sharing is one aspect of awareness raising. Other aspects is stuff like this, coming to talk to new audiences. So we're going to talk to schools, we're going to talk to businesses, we're going to talk to anyone that will bloody listen, to be honest with you, just to try and generally increase awareness. But there's something that I've really come to realise of late, which is quite a pinnacle in my understanding, which is not everyone is going to be a social entrepreneur. And that's fine, we're not trying to encourage everyone to be so. But everyone can get involved in some level of social action. I know the government's had a big sort of initiative around getting more youngins involved in social action. But personally, I think we can all be doing some level of social action, whether it's philanthropy, whether it's helping the old lady across the road, whether it's whatever it may be, we all have the power. So personally, if we're going to mainstream this movement, I feel that would be a good place to start, providing ways that everybody can get involved, and therefore it becomes more commonplace and acceptable to be doing these sorts of things. So thanks for the question.
Okay, one last one. It was really just a follow on from that point. I think one way that it's going to increase awareness about creating social enterprise about things which people use on an everyday basis. I do a lot of work with community energy groups and cooperatives, and people can buy into that. And that's something people use every day. They understand a lot, and once they invested in an energy cooperative, they think, oh, well, I can do this. Do cooperatives exist for other things as well? And, those cooperatives grow on everyday things, and energy is very successful at the moment, plus all the other things as well.
Divine Chocolate, Bellu Water, you know, it's these sorts of household names. There aren't enough household names in social enterprise, and I think you're right, there's definitely a trend towards more ethical consumerism, hence why Branson knows it and others know it, it's happening, and people are choosing to spend their money more consciously than they have ever been before. But again, I guess it's responding to that, and the sector sort of responding to that in the same way. And stuff like this is more collaboration, and in a way, increasing more awareness both on individual, institutional, and a sort of, you know, broader level. It's all important, really, at all stages.
Okay, Benjamin, is there anything you want to add?
Yes,
I'll be like first to thank the key speakers and to thank the audience to have come today. Sorry for my French accent. There are still some Europeans in Bristol, and there still will be. I brought, to be honest, when Oliver created that commission, I just started to say and to think, what can we bring? What can we bring new? Or how can we don't create something new, but just support and perform a synergy? Because there was such a strong backbone for charities, I thought, and for social enterprise. But there is still something which was missing, in my opinion, was really, we just spoke about that just before. There is still poverty. There is still people deprived of accessing the social mobility. Till this will exist, that means we have our essence, and we have to do something to change the mindset and in more holistic vision. So I just thought, what's the BGC DNA? We are into the business. What can we bring to these providers? They are providers, and they are new suppliers of what we could call the social economy. Charities, social enterprise, all together supporting and trying to change, and not only to take care about the symptoms, but really focusing on the root cause. How can we tackle that? this is what we want to do. This has not yet been done. I think that is the right timing to implement that. So how do we do that? Not alone. We have tremendous skills. Yes, we have lawyers, finance, a lot of solicitors. How can we bridge that skills? It happens that they need that skills when they are bidding on research and development programs, when they need the commercial, lawyer, financial skills. We can bring that, so I just thought, instead of just tailoring something new, we will have a working group within the Bristol Junior Chamber, where the members can pledge support all over the years. And when I say support, it's not only financially, it's skills and expertise. And we will be able, with key partners and key stakeholders like Bath and Bristol Regional Capital, like Quartet Community Foundation, like Social Enterprise Works, and of course with the enablers, like, I don't know, the technology finance, you know, to enable, because we are an enabler. And we can do that. I believe that, because impossible is not French. So it does not exist. And I know that Bristol is a rebel city, and we will bring that towards, the UK first. We will be the first UK social economic capital. That's what we want to do. So the first area, I finished almost on the point. The first area is our first October event will be as well an occasion for you to choose one of these projects. We are not opposing the cause, we are supporting all of them, obviously, which means you can still decide on your own to donate if you want, or pledge support to other projects which have been introduced before. October will be as well the opportunity and the momentum for the creation of the working group of the social economy, because let's use the big word, we don't speak enough, social enterprise, what is that, charities, social economy provider. And we, the BGC, are going to have other events during the year to enable the supply chain, because this is where they need our help, and this is what we can do easily. So we will deliver that, and of course it will be a lot of fun as well, not only it's a brain work. It will be also next year the idea of a convention summit of 3 days, where of course BGC would like to be involved in organizing, you know, these business meetings, workshop, and not only, yes, it is born in Bristol, but it is not only for Bristol, it will be for Bristol, and it's coming to the world. Born in Bristol. Voilà. We'll be right back.